Yes. That had that kind of rhythm to it. Our second verb phrase is number 227 in the hymn book, the friendly beasts. So it's a while out yet. Then it will fall on Sunday in 2039, 2044, and 2050. It's a cyclical occurrence that happens in intervals of 11, 6, 5, and then 6 years in a repeating cycle. So the dilemma is, what do we do on the Sunday after Christmas? Typically, we like to have a lot of Christmas music. So that's why I've chosen many of the hymns that we're singing this morning. But this year, it's also the first Sunday of Epiphany, the visit of the wise men. So we have to include them in our worship service. So welcome to 2023 and worship here this morning in the Fordyce United Methodist Church, where we will continue to celebrate work that God saw, and contemplate how we might respond to God when he intervenes in our lives. Announcements this morning. Our book study will continue this Wednesday at 10:15. This is session 4 and should be the last session in the series. Is there a need or desire for a church council meeting next Sunday, or would you prefer to move it out to the third Sunday in January? Yeah, let's move it out. Move it out to the third, so then we can finish up all of our year-end stuff. The verse I want to bring to your attention this morning is Matthew chapter 2, verse 2. The Magi were asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we have observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage."
Glory, love, hope, and mercy are served.
seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he arose again, according to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in the one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God, at all time, we praise and adore you for breaking into the darkness of this world with the glorious light of your presence, a light which made your love for the world visible in the babe born in Bethlehem, Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior, a light which guided those gift-bearing travelers from afar to find and worship the Christ child, a light which leads us to you, now revealed in Jesus Christ. We pray that you will accept our worship, for it arises from hearts and minds in awe over the humility of Jesus' name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And our next hymn is number 221 in the hymnal, In the Bleak Midwinter.
Oh. gospel lesson comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 2, verses 1 through 23. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star in its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out. And there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then opening their treasure chest, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. Now after they had left, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Get up. Take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother by night and went to Egypt and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I have called my son." When Herod saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, he was infuriated, and he sent and killed all the children in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had learned from the wise men. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. A voice was heard in Ramah, wailing and loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be consoled because they are no more. When Herod died, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel, for those who were seeking the child's life are dead." And Joseph got up, took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was ruling over Judea in place of his father, Herod, he was afraid to go there after being warned in a dream. He went away to the district of Galilee. There he made his home in a town called Nazareth, so that what had been spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled. He will be called a Nazarene. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. So the birth of the Son of God in a manger in Bethlehem of Judea is probably one of the most often told and celebrated events in human history. The Christian tradition of celebrating Christ's birth began sometime after the Roman Emperor Constantine converted to Christianity and declared Christianity to be the empire's official religion. Western Christians officially began celebrating December 25th as Christ's birthday in 336 AD, well over 300 years after his birth and earthly ministry. And Epiphany was introduced to Western Christianity somewhere around the 4th century as well. Now, the term Epiphany comes from a Greek word meaning appearance, manifestation, or revelation, and it often is linked to the visit of the wise men to the Christ child, which we read in Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Epiphany is also known as Theophany in Eastern Christian traditions, where it is a feast day celebrated on January the 6th. A Christmas celebration would be incomplete if we didn't remember the visit of the wise men to the child in Bethlehem. So the Greek word for wise men is magi, which means astrologer when translated to English. As astrologers, the wise men probably would have noticed the unusual appearance of the star in the night sky. It was not unusual then for them to follow this bright star to discover what was happening where it shone. The identity and the authority of this distinguished group is not as important as their objective. The Magi have had an epiphany with the discovery of the star in the east. They are traveling, seeking knowledge about this unknown phenomenon, which they think announces the birth of a new king of the Jews. Seeking is their response. Their first response to the revelation from the star. Their travels take them to Jerusalem and Herod. When Herod hears the story, he becomes a seeker as well. But Herod consults with those who should have known about the birth of the shepherd king in Bethlehem. Those people, chief priests and scribes, thank you. consult the Jewish Bible and come up with the information that the child will be born in Bethlehem. So Herod meets secretly with them and sends them on their way to Bethlehem in hope and asks them to return to him and bring him news of the child. Bethlehem is about a day's travel from Jerusalem, so the wise men's journey is almost done. When they arrive, they find the baby and his mother and father in a house. So he's not in the stable where he was born or the manger, which kind of indicates to us that the wise men may not have arrived for a year or more after the child was born. Their response to this discovery is to stop, to worship, and to offer gifts to the child. Then the wise men have another epiphany. In a dream, they're warned not to return to Herod. So now it's Joseph's turn for an epiphany. An angel appears to him and warns him that it's not safe for his family in Bethlehem. He flees with them to Egypt, where they will establish a new household in exile until it's safe to return to their home in Galilee. After Herod has died, another angel appears to Joseph in a dream, and he is told to go home. But in a third dream, he's warned that the new ruler, Herod Archelaus, is similar to his father, an iron-fisted ruler like Herod, whom Joseph had fled. So Joseph decides it's safer to settle in Galilee than to return to Judea. So when the wise men do not return, Herod himself has an epiphany. He realizes he's been tricked, and his fear increases with his rage that his kingdom has been threatened. The status quo is about to be overturned. Herod is frightened and angry. And our text this morning just tells us just how frightened Herod is by this news. Something is happening within his kingdom that resulted from something beyond his power. Herod's response to the news and the light was like that of the shepherds. He is afraid, and his fear turns to anger. He has no intention of paying homage to the child or laying gifts at his feet. So he sends men to Bethlehem to kill all the infants 2 years old or younger. This is a typical response of a tyrant whose only concern is to eliminate any threat to his reign. In a moment of epiphany, when the light is shining, when a glimpse of what is possible is given, that's when a vision of the depth of the love of God can come to all of creation, then there is only one proper response to such a moment of epiphany. Matthew tells us that the intent of the wise men from the very beginning was to worship. We have come to pay him homage, they declared in verse 2. And when they got there, where the child was, they stopped their wandering and took time to worship. So we know that Joseph had had several epiphanies. His response to God's intervention is faithfulness. Without understanding what's happening to him and his family, he's willing to listen to his dreams and follow through on them to protect this child which has been placed in his care. And Herod's response, of course, is self-preservation. He misses any possibility that God is at work here. He feared a tiny child because it seemed like a threat to his unstable mind. That threat leads him to send out a decree to kill all the children under the age of 2 in Bethlehem. But Herod's action is defeated by God, who intervenes and uses those he has chosen to save the child. God has and will continue to intervene in the world. Will we see the light? Will we have an epiphany? All are invited to celebrate God's work in the birth of his Son, who is his light to the world. We come to worship also, bearing gifts like the Magi. But our gifts are different than theirs. They came to worship the light, then left after offering gifts. But we come to worship the light. We with the gift of ourselves. We're here as followers of the light. We've seen the light grow into an adult, a shepherd king, who would indeed change the world. Our gift to God is to be a lamp shining in a dark place until that day dawns and the morning star rises in our hearts. The word and the work of God continues when we become that shining light like the shepherds and the magi follow for our families and our friends and our neighbors as we go through our everyday tasks. We can bring light into the dark places of the world, to the dark people of the world, like the Herods and chief priests and scribes, and others, when we share God's love with everyone we meet. God has intervened. God will continue to intervene. What he needs from us is an epiphany and response that shows the importance of loving him to the rest of the world. Amen. Would you join me for the unison prayer for Epiphany? Everlasting God, the radiance of faithful souls, you brought the nations to your light and kings to the brightness of your rising. Fill the world with your glory and show yourself to all the nations through him who is the true light and the bright and morning star, even Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Would you continue with me in silent prayer? Creator God, we thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, as the light in our world of darkness. Open our hearts and minds to his presence among us as we strive to be your light in our homes and neighborhoods, today and every day. We would ask, Lord, that you would be with those we have offered in our prayer list this morning. Comfort and strengthen them for whatever circumstances they face. And guide and direct us as we minister to them and others in this world, bringing light into those places where darkness, pain, and suffering still exist. We thank you, Lord, for the many blessings that you have showered down on all of us. And we pause now for a few moments of silent prayer to offer our private petitions directed to God's ears. Gracious and loving God, we are blessed by the birth of your Son in Bethlehem so long ago. May you continue to bless us by his presence in our lives as we journey down the path of love. All these things we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And our last hymn this morning is number 254 in the hymnal, We Three Kings.
Bearing gifts, redeemers of God.
May the Christ who, by his incarnation, gathered into one things earthly and heavenly, fill you with the sweetness of inner peace and goodwill, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Sending forth is Love Came Down at Christmas, number 242 in the